Good. Hello, Dan, Mari, et al. RM, Happy New Year. Yes, indeed. Indeed. How's the audio? You guys can hear me okay? Good.
Beautiful.
Today, we are going to begin with the Sphinx Within, second degree lesson 5, page 1. The individual book of judgment. Sounds like there could be some karma with this one. Isn't there with everything? There is indeed. But it's good stuff. It's good. And that's the beauty of these lessons, is that we get to experiment, you know, in a good way, obviously. Let's give it one more minute here, just in case. Okay. Well, Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. The happiest of New Years for everybody. Hopefully, healthiest, most prosperous, and joyous of New Years. I mentioned we will be starting on second degree lesson 5, The Sphinx Within. And before we begin, we will do our invocation and get connected. Just go ahead and be in a receptive pose. Place the tip of the tongue on the palate. To the great architect of the universe, Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, to Holy Master Choa, to Buddha Padmasambhava, to the Circle of Seven, to Robert and Erlin Cheney, to Master Astaleya, to Lord Kutumi, Lord Rama, Lord Zosir, to the Astarian hierarchy, to our celestial guides, our angel guides, our spiritual elders, our oversoul, higher souls, we humbly invoke for your great, great blessings. May we be a channel through which thy holy ones approach the world. May we be a center for the radiation of thy power. Teach us to travel light, that we may better gain the heights. Break the bonds that bind. Teach us to give ourselves entirely to thy service, to attune ourselves to thy will. Teach us to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God. Amen. Om Tat Tat So. All right. The Sphinx Within, second degree, lesson 5, the individual book of judgment. The history of human beings is the history of the glands, the story of evolution, The story of personal and spiritual progress is written unmistakably and indelibly in the glandular system. It tells a tale concerning the personality, as undeniable and as definite as each unique thumbprint. One who can read the glandular activities of an individual can read that person physically, mentally, emotionally, psychically, and spiritually, inside and out. The endocrine system is each person's individual personal Akashic record, the book of judgment. For as a person thinks and feels, so does the glandular system react. And as the glandular system reacts, so does that person think and feel. The two processes are so intimately intertwined as to be indistinguishable. The endocrine system, so far as esoteric scientists are concerned, consists of glands possessing ducts, glands possessing no ducts, called ductless glands. The glands possessing ducts release their substance into the ducts, which carry the secretions either to the surface of the body or to the alimentary canal. The ductless glands, on the other hand, release their secretions directly into the bloodstream or the lymph, whence they are carried all over the physical body. The principal endocrine glands are the pineal and pituitary in the head, the parathyroid, the thyroid, and the thymus in the throat and thoracic region, the spleen and the adrenals and the liver in the solar plexus and abdominal area, the testes in the male and the ovaries in the female in the sacral area. The liver, spleen, and reproductive organs are not considered endocrine glands by some glandular specialists. We include them, however, even though they do have a function outside the usual ductless activities. With or without ducts, all these important glands emit secretions which affect the entire physiological structure of the human body. Thus, they must be included in our research. All glands are organized groups of cells. They possess the uncanny ability to extract certain substances from the blood and the lymph to change them through some mysterious alchemical activity of their own, either by adding new chemical substances or using the materials from the blood to manufacture an entirely new type of substance and then release it back into the bloodstream. Since these secretions are distributed throughout the body, they exert their influence upon glands, cells, organs, and tissues far removed from the gland, expelling them. The influence of the pituitary, for instance, may be intense in the reproductive organs at the base of the spine as the bloodstream carries certain substances to that point. Glandular activities are conducted with such incredible wisdom that the individual glands know which secretions are meant for them and which are to be passed along to some other gland. Thus, the secretions meant for the reproductive organs will be received and utilized only by those and not by other glands. Some secretions, of course, are meant to influence all the glands. The physical form is a most intricate, excellent alchemical laboratory, and the endocrine glands are the points of highest chemical activities. Since humankind's earliest beginnings, our fundamental needs always have been met by a wise creator. As the human form, through interminable lengths of space and time, attained higher stages of physical perfection, and the evolutionary cycles brought perpetual mental development, so did the Creator begin to construct another spiritual center manifesting as another gland. Through the new gland, the evolving form received the forces, substances, essences, and hormones necessary to supply it with its changing needs. Thus, the glands have developed, and as we attain ever higher degrees of evolution, the glands will manifest increasing perfection, and more may slowly evolve to serve us in our greater expression. The glandular system can be compared to the nervous system in that both release messages which influence all bodily activities. Both are systems of intercommunication similar to powerful telephonic networks, and both release their chemical messages into their particular channels. That which is emitted by the nervous system is called nerve fluid. The substances emitted by the endocrines are called hormones. The word endocrine is a combination of two Greek words, endon, meaning within, and krinine, meaning to separate, which implies at once that endrikin refers to that which operates simultaneously within one unit, but also acts separately. This is a perfect description of the endrikin system. Each gland has its separate function and is capable of performing its own operation and producing its own mysterious hormonal fluid. Yet at the same time, they all combine to function as one unit, consolidating intricate alchemical operations. The word hormone is derived from the Greek word meaning to arouse or to set in action or to stimulate. This adequately describes the glandular secretions, since hormones released from one gland produce a stimulating effect upon other glands. Thus, again, the entire glandular system operates as one compact unit. The mystical aspect of the endocrines. We have said that the history of the glands is the history of humankind. That history is still in the process of being written. It is not completed by any means, nor will it be until our evolution is complete. As humankind evolves, so will the glands, and as the glands evolve, so will humankind. At present, we are the slaves of our endocrines in that the brain cells not only receive nourishment from the glandular secretions, but their functional processes are ordained by these secretions as well. The inner struggle of the lower human being with the oversoul is the result of the influence of the endocrine secretions in the brain. As the oversoul or superconscious mind gradually dominates the mental functions of the lower human being, the brain cells are increasingly activated, challenging the endocrines toward perpetual evolution. We ourselves must overcome the yoke of slavery imposed upon us by the endocrines as they, through personality, heredity, hold us to our karmic past. We can control the activities of the glandular system, but only with powerful personal effort, both mentally and emotionally, and few are endowed with such powers. The birth of all new ideas comes from a source outside the endocrines, the radiant oversoul. The influence of the oversoul upon the manifesting personality is indicated by the degree that the individual utilizes the inflow of new mental concepts and gives credence to new ideas. To that degree is one freed from habitual enslavement to the endocrines. The person who is afraid to express new thoughts and ideas in his or her life, and who follows in the dogmatic footsteps of habit-bound leaders, is one we call an endocrine slave. Any personality who surges ahead of the masses with New Age ideas, either in business, personal affairs, or in spiritual undertakings, can be recognized as one who is overcoming the domination of the glandular system. This is especially true of the religion a person follows. So long as one willingly subjects oneself to the domination of a religious leader who propounds psychological fears, just so long will this person remain a slave to the endocrines. The free soul, on the other hand, is the one who finds spiritual comfort and progression in the religion which gives free will, freedom from fear, and a choice of one's creeds. Animals are always slaves to the physiological functions of their endocrine secretions, and they cannot in any sense liberate themselves from these hormonal influences, because the endocrines themselves are the channels for the animalistic instincts which pour out from the group soul, dominating the particular species to which each belongs. These instincts are the true guardians of the animal kingdom. But as a human possessing his own soul, the one who refuses to think independently, who turns away from expanded mental horizons, whose eyes seek not the effulgent glory of spiritual self-unfoldment, is limiting his or her own potential. We become the creature having dominion over all the earth, in the exact proportion that we dominate our physiological endocrine functions. Each person does this through development of personal willpower, as we give birth to new thought patterns, as we strive to erase past karmic records and open ourselves to receive wisdom from spiritual leaders who urge us toward the freedom of our own soul. The endocrine system is indeed the Sphinx within, the unfathomable enigma confronting and confounding medical science. Only as the medical practitioner of tomorrow discovers the presence, the esoteric aspect, and the integration of the seven most powerful systems within this creature called the human being, can we completely understand ourselves. These seven systems are the nervous system, the nadi, the etheric nervous system, the etheric body, the chakras, the glands of the etheric body, the endocrine system, the three permanent seed atoms, the bloodstream, about which we shall write later, the physical seed atom in the heart. You guys want to do a little experiment? Yeah? Okay. So if we look at the seven systems, and we know that basically the three permanent seed atoms, especially the mental permanent seed, which is a recorder of all our thoughts, right? Physical permanent seed has our death dates. The emotional permanent seed is the recorder for all our emotions, right? So we also know that based on thoughts, emotions, speech, and actions, either from this incarnation or previous incarnations, that certain energies are released into the physical permanent seed and then into the bloodstream, right? And those are the picture images that are in the blood. So why don't we do an experiment, a healing experiment, because you know I like to do healing experiments, and work on these seven systems. I don't want to mess with the physical permanency. We'll just do the mental and do the emotional, okay? And let's see if there is a shift or expansion in peace or stillness as we remove some of the old habits, right? And as we are into 2023, we want to kick out 2022, get rid of it, right? Okay, so just be receptive. Just make sure the tongue is connected, your palms are in a receptive pose. Make sure your legs are not crossed so you're not blocking the energy. Lord Kutumi, Lord Kutumi, Lord Kutumi. May all incarnated souls be transformed. May all incarnated souls be redeemed. May all incarnated souls be sanctified. May all incarnated souls be cleansed and purified. May all incarnated souls be consecrated to change their thinking toward holiness. This we ask in thy name and the Astarian hierarchy. Amen. May the mental body, emotional body of all incarnated souls on this call be purified, have thoughts of love, of joy, of happiness, of peace. In the nervous system, be gently and lovingly cleansed and purified. Mental permanency, may it be cleansed of all negative thought patterns, negative habits, negative trends. May the emotional permanency be cleansed of all negative emotions, negative habits, negative emotional trends. The sympathetic, the pineal, and the pituitary, may they be cleansed and purified. Pineal, cleansed and purified. Pituitary, cleansed and purified. Parathyroid, left and right lobes and the thymus and the thyroid, cleansed and purified. Thymus, left lobe, right lobe, cleansed and purified. Liver and pancreas and the spleen, gently and lovingly cleansed and purified. Adrenals, gently and lovingly cleansed and purified. Just whisper, I fully release all repressed emotions and any and all lack of forgiveness. Cleanse and purify the back solar plexus and the Ming Men. Cleanse and purify the male reproductive organs and the female reproductive organs. Cleanse and purify. Gently, lovingly cleanse and purify. May the etheric body be cleansed and purified. Release. Shushumna Nadi, cleanse and purify. And release. Straighten the health rays. Release, 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 release. Cleanse and purify the frontal, temporal, occipital, parietal, cerebellum, cerebrum, dente, gyrus, hippocampus, amygdala, the fornix, cingulate gyrus, cortex. Cleanse and purify the basal ganglia. Cleanse and purify gently and lovingly. The entire brain is completely cleansed and purified. All negative picture images in the blood are disintegrated, externalized, released, and properly disposed of. Disintegrate, disintegrate, disintegrate any and all negative picture images in the blood. Lord Kutumi, Lord Kutumi, Lord Kutumi. Yes, this in thy name. All negative picture images in the blood are cleansed and purified. All negative picture images in the lymphatic system are gently and lovingly cleansed and purified. Cleansed and purified gently and lovingly. Under the armpits, elbows, hands. Under the armpits, elbows, hands. Hips, back of the knees, soles of the feet, below the feet. Cleanse and purify the thoracic, cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and sacral. Cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and sacral, gently and lovingly cleansed and purified. May the Shushumna Nadi be filled with Ananda, 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 divine bliss. May we gently and lovingly energize the pineal and the pituitary. Stabilize, stabilize, stabilize. Is that too much energy? Everybody okay? How does that feel? A little more peaceful? Yeah? Good, good, good. I love these teachings because we get to do this, you know? So cool. All right. The physical seed atom in the heart. We have explained in lesson 14, first degree, about the three permanent atoms, the physical seed atom in the heart composed of physical plane energies, the astral emotional seed atom in the solar plexus composed of astral substance, the mental seed atom in the pineal gland composed of substance from the mental plane. We become co-creators with God as only as we gradually liberate ourselves from the influence of our glandular secretions. We are held to this claim, to this chain of slavery by our inherited karma, registering first through the heart seed atom and then through the glands. But our future freedom will well depend upon three things: the use we make of our own individual willpower as we, through spiritual means, strive to overcome the influence of past karma in our lives, our attempts to balance the chaotic flow of undesirable picture images released by the heart seed atom with the powerful constructive picture images of the present as they are released by the mental and astral seed atoms, the constructive way we utilize the hormonal secretions of our glands, our inner urges, which drive us either upward or downward, forward or backward, to love, to hate, to feel everything that we experience within, rise up from the endocrine glandular system as it receives the picture images distributed by the heart seed atom into the bloodstream. The seed atoms are dispensers of karma. To clarify the picture more completely, let's consider again the biblical scripture, the sins of the father are visited upon the children, even unto the fourth generation. As we previously explained, this does not refer to our earthly fathers and their earthly sins. This would imply that we must personally bear the karmic burden and responsibility of our parents, grandparents, and indeed our forefathers. This would be a flagrant miscarriage of divine justice. It means that we ourselves are the parents of our own future, whether it be good or bad, according to our actions in this present life, and that we today are the child of what we fathered, the actions we created in past incarnations, even unto four incarnations ago. It means that we might now be repeating our karmic rewards or punishments earned by ourselves as far back as four generations, as it is symbolized in the Bible. To exemplify further, let us say that four incarnations ago, you deliberately committed some deed which cost some fellow being his eyesight. It inevitably follows that in some lifetime, you must pay your debt. You must balance your cosmic books. You must reap what you have sown. Since cosmic law demands that karmic records be made even within four generations, this lifetime closes the cycle during which you must clear your record, balance your cosmic books, and erase all karmic traces of deeds committed four incarnations ago. So at some time during this incarnation, the heart seed atom will begin releasing to the glands its atomic picture images bearing the message of I weakness. As the glands receive this message, it does not necessarily follow that you must completely lose your eyesight, but the glands will automatically begin to withhold from the bloodstream some needed hormone, which will register as a general weakening throughout the body. If your eyes have been particularly abused during this incarnation, then they most surely would be affected, possibly seriously. But if you have taken care to preserve their power and strength, the hormone deficiency would affect some other weaker organ. In other words, the deficiency would revert to and attack the organ in your physical form, which exhibited the greatest weakness. It might be the heart, or the kidneys, or the liver, or gallbladder, and not the eyes at all. Wherever your weakness lies, there will develop your ailment. One very important point must be made particularly clear, and that is, when an illness befalls you, look first for an immediate physical cause and not for a long ago karmic cause. Never, never accept any condition, weakness, or illness as being karma against which you can neither cope nor hope. Karma extending back four incarnations is rare. This teaching is presented only because it does occasionally happen. But in the vast majority of cases, the cause of any illness can be traced to some very present karmic action of this incarnation, such as bad diet, undesirable liquids, stress, worry or confusion, even faulty elimination, or some equally common current cause. There are also the equally devastating seeds born of hate, prejudice, anger, jealousy, and avarice. Personal choice of karma. It is seldom that a karmic condition will extend over a period of the permitted four incarnations. It usually will be erased in the same lifetime the deeds are committed. Much depends upon the quality of the deeds. If one is a hardened criminal, it may well require four incarnations to blot this record, for the heart seed atom to release the atomic picture images at a rate bearable to this soul who has perpetrated such heinous deeds against other human beings. Let us use the eyes as our example again. Let us assume that in a certain lifetime you blinded someone, not accidentally, but with evil intent and purpose. Then, before you incarnate again, you make your own decision concerning your next incarnations in discharging your karmic debt. When the time approaches for your incarnation following the one in which your crime was committed, your celestial guardian may remind you that you carry a karmic debt of blindness. You may have a choice of whether or not you wish to endure one complete life or one life of complete blindness or four lives of partial blindness. Many of us are given choices in these matters so that it can truly be said that God places no more upon us than we can endure. The things which sometimes seem unbearable are conditions which we ourselves may have chosen. The seed atom in the heart is the true controller of the entire body, the king of destiny in every sense of the word. The atom, with its file of karmic atomic particles,
holds us completely in its power. Yet at the same time, it is only a record of what we have done to ourselves. The endocrines can manifest only that which the seed atom will allow. And the seed atom is, in turn, only a storage file of what we have made of ourselves in the past. As the seed atom slowly becomes cleared of its dismal record of the past, we gradually will become liberated from our slavery to the endocrines, and the endocrines will grant us ever-increasing freedom. It is as if the endocrines were a council of sages in the human form, which says to the personality inhabiting the body, prove to us that you have the willpower to overcome the world, and we will then give you our full support in carrying out every new plan, all your new ideals, helping you in every way to rejoice in your hard-won freedom from our rhythms and cycles of destiny. Well, so be it. The endocrine system is the person's inheritance of the past. The results manifesting in the individual through the glandular system have their cause in the roots of previous lives and foreshadow the person this is to be. It must be understood, of course, when we make this statement that the glandular system is only the book of the record and not the writer of the record, it can manifest only that which is released to it by the seed atom, and the seed atom is only the instrument of the incarnating personality, who is the true creator of the record. The network of intercommunication between the glands, seed atoms, and bloodstream, as they combine to help us in our evolution, is witness to incredible wisdom. Certain glandular conditions are an invitation to a life of crime, and other glandular conditions open the gates to godhood. Certain glandular conditions help create a genius. Others develop a less than average intellect. Each person can rise only as high as his or her individual glandular system, operating under higher influences, will allow. The glandular system is the outer voice of our past karma. The seed atom is the inner. The glandular system is also our book of judgment, so far as our future is concerned. What we think and do in this present life will determine the glandular system we will manifest in our next incarnation. The glandular secretions operating through the nervous systems mirror the degree of our personal magnetism. Depending upon the nerve fluid as it impinges upon the endocrines, we become a dynamic personality or a nondescript individual. As the glands go, so we go. We are victims of our endocrine system and the rulers simultaneously. The endocrines and the mind. The endocrine system is the agent of the subconscious mind, operating under orders from the pituitary, who receives her commands from the heart seed atom. With future evolvement of the cerebrospinal, the agent of the superconscious, we will direct with our waking conscious mind the flow of the endocrine secretions into our systems, increasing and decreasing them as needed for our true and perfect life expression. As you develop your two highest senses, clairvoyance and intuition, through the pineal and the pituitary glands, just so will you bring your cerebrospinal nervous system into increasing power as your superconscious mind begins to make its presence felt in your outer life. The pituitary and pineal glands are the physical focal points for the activity of the spirit within. The glands located in the trunk of the body are the vehicles through which the lower aspect, the personality, manifests under orders from the pituitary. The progress of the glands in the trunk will be the story of the regenerative process as we leave the limited material scope of all of our five senses and reach toward the development of our sixth and seventh senses, controlled by the pineal and the pituitary in the head. The three glandular centers most prominently active in the personality of today are the brow chakra and the anterior pituitary activated, the solar plexus with the liver, the seat of baser emotions activated, the root chakra at the base of the spine with the reproductive organs activated. As the glandular system operating in conjunction with the evolving nervous system becomes more balanced and integrated, the prominent centers will be the third eye, including the pituitary and the pineal, combined in their more spiritual functions, the heart center, activating the thymus gland and transmuting the solar plexus emotions into divine love, the sacral and coccygeal centers with the adrenals and spleen balanced and equalized in their positive-negative hormone flow and activities. With the dissipation of undesirable karmic picture images in the heart seed atom, and with the unfolding powers of the superconscious mind, we will cease to be dominated by our endocrines, victims of our own recorded past mistakes, and will become guides of our future destinies. It will be a happy day when humankind has finally erased the greatest portion of our unpleasant karma. The tremendous evolutionary strides will become evident in our ever-accelerating pace toward immortality and perfection, the seed atom, the glands, and death. Even though we have covered the death process in the first degree, a brief repetition might be in order so far as the glandular action is concerned, since this lesson relates to the glands. When the physical seed atom in the heart, which carries in itself the pattern of death as well as life, releases the elements which notify the endocrine system that death of the physical form is imminent, the glands respond and inject into the bloodstream a mysterious substance which gathers in ever-increasing power around the heart center. This mysterious death hormone is the final analysis, is the basic cause of death. Flowing throughout the glandular system by means of the blood, it labors to loosen the etheric nervous system, the nadi, so that the etheric form may depart gently. This detachment of the etheric form starts in the minor nerve centers behind the eyes. As it is gradually freed, the entire spiritual body gravitates toward the head centers through the process of magnetic attraction and begins its action of complete withdrawal. There is simultaneous activity in progress as the mental seed atom withdraws from the physical form. Usually, the consciousness cord breaks with the departure of the mental atom, followed by the departure of the emotional seed atom. The final effort of death hormone is to free the heart seed atom from the surrounding cells and atoms of the physical form. It eventually carries the atom upward through the vagus nerve to the head center, then upward through the silver cord as the spiritual form slowly withdraws. With the passing of the heart seed atom, the silver cord breaks and the physical form is indeed dead. Supplemental monograph, The Mystic Death. In the Holy Bible and other scriptures, there are several references to the sound of many waters heard while being in the spirit and listening to the sound of the trumpet. Very near the beginning of his Book of Revelation, John of Patmos writes, "I was in the spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet." Revelation. With the development of the higher bodies, the astral, mental, and causal, these spiritual sounds become clearer and transmit a deeper sense of ecstasy. This is possible because the higher vehicles serve as finer instruments of attunement to the keynotes of the universe. In the mysteries, during a candidate's first initiations, the Hierophant would place him or her in a deep hypnotic trance and, using mystical powers, would unite the candidate with the divine sound. In this hypnotic state, the Hierophant would help the candidate escape temporarily from the physical body to gain knowledge on the upper planes. Returning to the body, the candidate thus completely understood death and the afterlife. This experience in the mysteries was called the mystic death. In later initiations, the initiate, through contact with the divine sound, attained the transforming second birth. During the mystic death, the candidate actually passed through an experience closely resembling what we term death. The conscious awareness in the inner worlds, however, removed all fear of actual death from the mind. In fact, made the candidate eager to experience the mystic death again and again and look forward to real death with anticipation rather than dread. The Astarian who practices Lama Yoga attempts to bring about the same mystic death experience by the development of your own mental and spiritual powers and your attunement to the divine sound, the holy nod. When the initiate Paul said, "I die daily," 1 Corinthians 15:31, he referred to this mystic death, which he experienced frequently, meaning he could leave his body at will for journeys into the higher planes. In the second letter to the Corinthians, he refers to his experiences in a guarded manner by saying, I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. Such and one caught up to the third heaven, and I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. How that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. 2 Corinthians 12, chapters 2 through 4. The practice of Lama Yoga and the holy nod could well unfold this inner power. However, persistent attunement to mystical and esoteric studies can also confer the same inner power upon the Astarian who does not practice Lama Yoga. Developing the ability to merge with the sound, you too may indeed find that you are able to expand your consciousness to encompass the astral, the mental, the causal, and even under certain circumstances, the Buddhic plane. This supplement is meant to give the Astarian candidate for initiation some pointers which might help you better to attain these goals, to offer a better understanding of the inner journey, what to expect, and what the inner journey really means. The unlimited potential. You may not wish to carry Lama Yoga to the point of a conscious out-of-body experience for fear you may be unable to re-enter your physical body. This should never be a matter of grave concern, for as long as the silver cord connected to the physical remains intact, nothing can prevent your re-entry. The silver cord breaks only at the moment of physical death, and only the process of death can sever it. Therefore, set your fears at rest. Your main consideration is to bring a sharper remembrance of the inner mystical experiences to the conscious mind. However, should you experience fright or discomfort in any of your journeys, you have only to turn your attention earthward again, and you will automatically be pulled back toward your body immediately, no matter how far away you may find yourself. You must always, and this is important, you must always immediately write down all that you remember. If you do not, no matter how vivid it may seem at the time, it will slip away rapidly away. And later, you will be unable to recall much that might prove to be extremely important. Overcoming the obstruction consciousness. Let us consider first the prospect of astral consciousness and establish guideposts for the Astarian who already may be consciously crossing the threshold into the astral world. Try not to hold steadfastly to any preconceived idea about what you are going to discover there. Release from your mind any notions about hellfire and brimstone, the devil, golden streets and harps. Try to approach your wider visions as a child, open-minded, eager to learn. One of the first things you discover about the astral is that there are no obstacles. It is part of your normal consciousness to fear fire, falls from heights, impacts from any object, drowning. But in spiritual journeys, these concerns may be completely dismissed. It requires considerable mental training to learn this elementary astral lesson. Until you experience it, you will not know, for instance, that your astral body can pass directly through a mountain if you so desire. You may even penetrate the earth, investigating the inner workings of the planet. However, you cannot do these things so long as your consciousness considers them obstructions, for you will place your own limitations upon yourself and your experiences. For instance, you will be unable to pass through a wall in your home while in your spiritual body unless you first learn that it can be done by actually doing it. Once accomplished, it becomes part of your consciousness. Never accomplished, you will be convinced that it cannot be done. It requires considerable courage to overcome subconscious fears. So an early lesson to learn concerning the astral is that it is an unobstructed universe. It is important to remember that your astral vision may be out of focus until you have enjoyed considerable experience there. Thus, if someone requests a description of your journey, instead of adopting a definitive or a definite attitude about what life is like in the astral, be flexible in your opinions, ready to admit that you are a neophyte, if you are, and that further experience may prove your first impressions entirely wrong. Reading the Akashic Records. Let us say that you have an intense desire to read the Akashic Records. All the seven planes of life interpenetrate each other. And therefore, someone on the physical plane could come in rapport with the substance from the higher planes, since it lies all about you, awaiting your sensitivity. See Lesson 10, First Degree. Every thought, word, and deed of yours is recorded in the ethers of the Buddhic plane, the record of which is sometimes called the Book of Judgment. A sage once wrote, "I hear a voice that cries, 'Alas, alas, whatever hath been written shall remain, nor be erased, nor written o'er again. The unwritten only still belongs to thee. Take heed and ponder well what that shall be.'" We have said that a complete record is found on the Buddhic plane. A reflection of these true Akashic records may be found on the astral. A lesser reflection is also found on the physical, ensouled in the mental reflecting ether. It should be remembered always that a reflection of anything is not always a perfect image. This is also true of these mystic records, and the disciple who attempts to read them must remember that you are viewing only the etheric or astral reflection of the actual records. You are reading from an inaccurate reproduction, which cannot present a perfect picture of the real words, thoughts, and deeds originally expressed. Only a master who has fully developed the causal body would be able to view the true records on the Buddhic plane. Now, how do we go about reading these records? Reading the Book of Life. Infinite intelligence, it appears, constructed a human television set inside the head millenniums before we learned to build a mechanical replica. The third eye, including the pineal, the pituitary, the third ventricle, and the optic thalamus, truly compares with an incredible television set. The eye, when properly attuned, captures the sights and sounds of the higher planes. The yogi practices concentration upon an object in order to procure knowledge of that object. This yogic practice is to be applied regarding the study of the Akashic records while sitting in meditation. Project a powerful concentration of mental energy toward the object of your investigation, holding to the intense desire that the records reveal some knowledge about that object or situation. This is not to say that you will send your mind power in any given direction to any given locale. You will simply hold fast to your desire. Let no outer disturbances sway your mind. Faithful concentration will bring revelations to you. You may view the records either subjectively or objectively. One of two things may occur. You may step out of your body and view the inner world objectively. You may remain conscious in your physical form and view the scenes subjectively. The objective view will most probably be seen while you are on a spiritual journey. It will seem as if you suddenly find yourself living in other surroundings, with activities going on about you, with people strangely familiar enacting vaguely familiar scenes, with yourself as a part of the scenes. It will seem as real to you as your earth life, an entire lifetime with all its struggles, loves, sorrows, and joys might be enacted, or the scenes might shift from one life to another, with you always participating. When you regain your normal consciousness, you will recall all that you witnessed, but it will seem as though you had a vivid dream. You will know, of course, that it was no dream, but an experience in projected consciousness. Dream, however, is the only words which can describe the sensation you are apt to experience. This will be viewing the scenes objectively. The subjective view is witnessed while remaining consciously in the physical body. It will appear to you as if there is a movie screen just inside your forehead, and you are witnessing the passing review from the back of your head. Indeed, it may seem as if you yourself are standing inside your own head, near the back, watching scenes unroll on a tiny screen on the inner side of your forehead. You will have the sensation of sitting in a movie, or before a television set or computer screen, watching yourself portray a role in a motion picture. You will recognize yourself, but will feel separate and apart from the self you are viewing. Just as before, you may follow one complete lifetime, or the scenes may change, skipping from one lifetime to another. In these experiences, you may find a study of historic records to be of vast interest. You may desire revelations concerning lost civilizations or some particular personality in history. These and other objectives can be achieved with power and patience. However, whether you wish this type of revelation or whether you wish to gain information about your own past lives, a warning must be voiced. Be extremely cautious about discussing your findings, particularly about your own past lives. Keep silent. The mark of the neophyte, or of one who is off on a wrong track, is one who too eagerly proclaims who he was in some past life. It is extremely unlikely that you can tune in with your own past in your early experiments, even though you may see many scenes moving before your vision. It is most important, especially in this particular investigation, to abolish from your mind any preconceived notions as to who you may have been. Try to become indifferent about it, for truly it matters very little. Who you are and what you are today is the important thing to remember. A strong idea or hope on your part as to who you might have been can throw your whole vision of the records out of focus, for you will be forced to view them through the shadow of thought forms created by your own desires. Always view with distrust any would-be spiritual teacher who claims to have access to the Akashic records and who is eager to enlighten you about your former incarnations. Only the wise can gain access to the true records, and the wise would avoid disclosing such information about yourself. When you are ready to bear such knowledge, when you have gained a proper measure of spiritual unfoldment, your own oversoul will reveal it to you, melting into the sound. Let us say that you wish to soar up and up far beyond the confines of the astral, beyond the mental, the causal, and into the radiant celestial realms. The surest means of attaining such heights is to merge with the current of the divine sound. And the best way to merge with the sound, the holy nod, is to float inward on the mental energy currents of Aum. To better open the inner faculties, to hear the divine sound, one must close off the outer faculties. It is better to close your eyes, put stoppers in your ears, and lock the tongue in order for the inner channels to open. If the eyes remain open, much of the needed mental energy is dissipated outward in the use of the sense faculty of seeing. This same is true of hearing and tasting. Locking the tongue means to turn it upward and touch the palate, then forcing the tip backward as far as possible. This will close the throat, forcing the upflowing spinal creative energies into the brain centers and the brain dews downward into the Shushumna. More will be given concerning this when we teach the Pad Nirvana, the next step of Lama Yoga. If you find it difficult to lock your tongue on the physical tongue, then lock the tongue of your thoughts, speaking mentally over and over the chant of Aum, which is in effect calling the Lord's name over and over. It is better to close your eyes and concentrate on the midway point inside your head than it is to find an outer object to gaze upon. For in the latter, the energy is pouring outward to center upon the object instead of inward to center upon the divine sound. Energy follows thought, and we want the energy currents flowing inward. If you require an object upon which to concentrate, imagine an inner light shining inside your head. Keep your gaze centered upon the light, or imagine that the master's eyes are just inside your head and you are gazing into them. Hold to these three steps. With the eyes closed, keep trying to see the eyes of the master in the center of the head. With the tongue locked, keep mentally repeating the word Aum. With the ears closed, keep struggling to hear the inner sound of the divine current. I'll tell you what, we will start, well, actually we'll end with a little experiment here for a couple minutes. So connect the tongue to the palate and close the eyes and just center on the pineal gland, on the mental permanent seed. Imagine a popsicle stick going from the upper tip of the ear through the head to the upper tip of the other ear, and from the ajna to the back of the head. And where those two imaginary sticks intersect is where the pineal gland is. Then the pituitary is just below that. So what we're going to do is we're going to focus first on the pineal gland, the mental permanent seed in the pineal. And we're going to do Om 3 times. And then I'm going to move down to the pituitary gland and do Om 3 times. And see how that experience is. So we just go ahead and close your eyes. Be aware of the pineal gland. And you can listen to the sound of the Om. Mentally, you can chant the Om. Imagine the energy from the Om expanding in all directions, and you are one with that light. Gently move the awareness down to the pituitary gland, just slightly below, or just silently repeat pituitary gland 3 times. Be aware of the Om and the stillness in between the Oms. Allow your consciousness to expand. Move your awareness up and be, let it expand and just let go.
through the Supreme One of the Light, fill our consciousness with the sublime realization of your exalted presence while we are attuned with your divine vibrations. Touch us with your spirit that our thoughts may be quickened. Keep us steadfast in our search for your truth and reveal to us the workings of your laws. May your peace and consciousness and love descend upon us now and enfold, embrace, shield, protect, bless, and heal us with your love everlasting. Om. Amen. Om. Gently bring your awareness back to your bodies. Gently move your fingers, move your toes. How was that? Good. Listen, I will let you enjoy the bliss, enjoy the stillness. Feel free to experiment. Continue the experiment with the pineal, the pituitary, and the Om, the holy nod. And we will see you on the 9th, hopefully, for the global prayer for healing. Have a beautiful, beautiful rest of the week, morning, day, night, wherever you are. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Namaste, precious souls. Thank you so much. Happy, happy New Year, too. We'll see you soon. Namaste.